welcome everybody on this first Sunday in August to church today. How many of you feel like summer is flying by? And if it's flying by, I hope that you're experiencing some refreshment in the summer. I know oftentimes people go away on vacation hoping to be refreshed, but you go away on vacation, coming home wanting a vacation from your vacation so that you can be refreshed from your vacation. Any of you following along with that? And so this week I Googled this phrase, how to be refreshed. A list of five things popped up at the top. If you were to create five ways to be refreshed, what would be the things that would come to your list? See if any of them are on this list. According to Google, how to be refreshed, number one, take a walk outside. Now, I like to take walks outside for sure, but this would all have to be like in context. I wouldn't find it very refreshing to take a walk outside when it's 93 degrees and muggy, right? Or in a hailstorm or on a summer evening in Illinois that's mosquito infested, but maybe for some of you, taking a walk brings refreshment. Number two is this. I thought this was going to be number one on the list. It's drink a glass of water. How many of you have heard that? Like if you're thirsty, drink a glass of water, that'll be refreshing. But how many of you, you would rather than water have maybe like a Diet Coke or a lemonade or coffee? I find coffee a lot more refreshing personally. Number three, this was very, very specific. It was, seemed odd in this list. Breathe in lemon essential oil. So let's just kind of like practice this. Let's pretend that this room is filled with the aroma of lemon essential oil. And let's just take a deep breath and then exhale. Let's do it together. Feel more refreshed? We'll see. Number four is eat something healthy. Now, I don't know about you, but ice cream for sure is more refreshing than kale salad to me. Number five, take a nap. How many of you miss those days when you were like a kid and you got to take a nap like every day? And then you like grow up and you take a nap and then you wake up from your nap and you're more groggy than you were before you took a nap. And sometimes it can be refreshing. Sunday afternoons, sometimes I take a nap. Any of you planning on taking a nap today? Anybody? No, anyone? No one's planning on taking a nap, hopefully in the sermon. So top five things according to Google, how to be refreshed. Of course, these are all physical things that lead to temporary refreshment. Here, we're going for something a lot deeper. We're not going for the physical, we're going for the spiritual. We're not going for the temporal, we're going for the eternal. Get this, jot this down, that only the power and presence of Jesus can refresh the deepest longings of our soul. Can I get an amen? Only the power and presence of Jesus can refresh the deepest longings of our soul. We're digging into John chapter 4. We're continuing our series, Unsung, looking at everyday people with uncommon faith. And today we're getting to the story of the woman at the well. And perhaps this is a story really familiar to you. It's a story that's familiar to me. But as I spent some time in this passage this week, I found not just the simplicity of the story, but I found a lot of profound things in the story that I trust will minister to your heart as it's ministered to me. It's really a great story of how God seeks us and how God loves us and how God forgives us and how God gives us life. And before we dig into John chapter 4, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for this opportunity to gather together to worship you. God, we thank you that you are here in this place. God, I pray that you would bring refreshments to our soul as we dig into your word today. God, would you reveal yourself to us in some new and some fresh ways like you did to the woman at the well so many years ago. And so God, speak to us through your word. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So the title of this message is Refreshed by Living Water. Here's point number one. My source of refreshment is Jesus. My source of refreshment is Jesus. John chapter 4, starting in verse 7, a woman from Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." And then in parentheses, verse 8, for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy some food. Well, in order for us to be able to understand this passage, we need to understand its context. We need to understand the historical context, the geographical context, as well as the cultural context. Let's start with the historical context. Well, in 722 BC, the Assyrians conquered Israel, and they took the 10 northern tribes into captivity. And the Gentiles came in from different areas to this land, and they intermingled and intermarried with the Jews. Now, God's word does not condone interrace marriage in any way, but it condones interfaith marriage. And over time, these people became known as Samaritans. The Samaritans developed their own religion. It was part pagan and part Judaism. They worshiped on Mount Gerizim, and we'll talk about that in a moment. And there was a lot of animosity between Jews and Samaritans, and that animosity was mutual. I know the NFL season is coming. It's training camp. Any Bears fans in the house? Any Bears fans? How do you feel about Packer fans? So, your response to that is a little bit offensive to me as a Packer fan. But if you understand the animosity between Bear fans and Packer fans, you're understanding the animosity between Jews and Samaritans. Or you think about the animosity on Capitol Hill between Democrats and Republicans. That's the kind of thing that's going on with the Jews and the Samaritans. That's the historical context. The geographical context is this, is that there were three regions that were kind of stacked on top of each other. At the top was Galilee, in the middle was Samaria, and then down at the bottom was Judea. And if you have a map at the back of your Bible, you can probably find something that would be similar to this. And the Jesus and the disciples, they were going to be traveling from Jerusalem up to Galilee, and there were a couple of routes that they could take. How many of you, when you go on a trip, especially if you go on a trip to somewhere you don't know, you get on your GPS or you get on your phone to Google Maps, and then you type in the address, and then you have like a route, and then you have an alternative route. You've seen that before, and that's really the options that Jesus and his disciples had. The main route, the easiest route, the quickest route for sure, was just to go north, to go right through Samaria. But the Orthodox Jews back then would take the alternate route. They would go way out of their way and take a lot longer just so that they would avoid Samaria because of the animosity that they had to the Samaritans. They would cross the Jordan River and then go up through Perea, then cross the Jordan River back again to get to Galilee. But Jesus and his disciples, they went straight north. They went through Samaria. And they got to this place kind of in the middle of Samaria called Sychar. Sychar was right next to Mount Gerizim, and it was like the convergence of some trade routes. So if you think about like interstates and how interstates go north and south and east and west, and cities are built around the intersection of interstates, that's basically what Sychar was. And it was built with this trade route going on. And so Jesus and his disciples, they go up through, and they get to Sychar. That's the geographical context. The cultural context would be this, is that there was a lot of prejudice going on in that day, not unlike today. There was racial prejudice. We already talked about the animosity between the Jews and the Gentiles, that there was gender prejudice, that the suppression of women was a massive in the day of Jesus, but Jesus himself, you're never going to find a character in the Bible that raises the elevation of the value of women more than Jesus. Just read the Gospels and you'll see that here in the story. And then there's moral prejudice, that when people don't conform to an outward set of standards, that there is the shaming and the shunning and the bad behavior towards them. And so that was what was going on. Sadly, these prejudices still exist today in our society. May they not exist in the church. May they not exist in this church. So here is Jesus. Jesus is a Jewish man, and he's talking to a sinful Samaritan woman. He's addressing prejudice head on in this passage. Well, in John chapter 4, verse 3, it says that Jesus and his disciples had to go through Samaria. Did they have to go through Samaria? No, they could have taken the alternative route that most Jews would have taken. But they chose to go right through Samaria. And so as they're going through Samaria, Jesus is going to have an opportunity to reach people. In order to reach people, you need to go where they are. Think about like a firefighter. A firefighter isn't going to come to a house that's burning and stand outside of the house and yell in with a megaphone, "Hey, get out of your house, it's burning." What's the firefighter going to do? The firefighter is going to go inside the house to where the people are at and bring them out to safety. If you are going to reach your neighbors, if you are going to reach your neighborhood, you need to get out of your house. You need to meet your neighbors and interact with your neighbors. If we as a church are going to have an impact in this community, we need to get out of the walls of our church and be involved in our community. You need to go where people are at, and that's what's happening with Jesus, is that he is going to where the Samaritans are at. And so he and his disciples, they get to Sychar, and it's kind of like this rest stop in the journey. Remember in parentheses it said that the disciples, they went into town to get some food. I don't know if they went to go get fillet of fish from McDonald's or that Christian chicken, the chicken sandwich with the pickle from Chick-fil-A. But they went to go get carry out to go because it's just a rest stop. We need to get up to Galilee. And while they're going in to get food, Jesus is sitting at the well. And the disciples come back and they're like, "We got to keep going." But Jesus was living on a different mission than what his disciples were. If you know anything about the Steiner family, I've shared this before. If you know anything about our road trips, that how we roll as a family is we only stop when the gas gauge is on empty. And so, unfortunately for Camille and our kids, we have a fairly fuel-efficient Honda Odyssey that can go about 500 highway miles. So we're about 7 hours between our stops. And we got one of these countdown, like the mileage countdown in tells you how many miles you have to go. Did you know that you can get to zero and still go? Did you know that like zero isn't zero? You still have like a couple of gallons to go. You can like squeeze out probably another 50 miles. And so that's how we travel together as a family. And when we stop, it's like, okay, you got to do your potty, you got to get your food, we got to get gas, and then it's back on the road and we got to keep going. The disciples were like this. They went into town, they went to go get food, they come to Jesus and they're like, "We got to get going," but Jesus was operating on a different schedule. Jesus was about doing his Father's business. And so here is Jesus, he's sitting at this well. It's Jacob's well. It's a well that would have been dug like 1,500 years before, and it would have gone down about 150 feet to this natural spring. And people from all around would come and they would get their water. Normally they would come in the morning or the evening in the cool of the day. But this woman from Samaria comes at high noon at the hottest part of the day when most people aren't there. Perhaps she's going because she doesn't want to interact with anyone. She's ashamed of who she is, and she knows that people know who she is. Have you ever traveled before, gotten on a train or on a plane? It's like, I just want to put my headphones on. I don't want to talk to anyone. You go to a social setting, and you feel awkward, and you don't want to make eye contact because you really don't want to be there. Maybe she's going because she doesn't want to interact with anyone. And what does Jesus do? Jesus asks her a question. He says, "Give me some water," but it's not like demanding, "Give me some water." It's like, "Will you give me some water?" You see, Jesus was thirsty, and she had some water that he needed. But he, as we're going to see in this passage, has some water that she needs. Jesus was thirsty and he knew it, but this woman was also thirsty, but she didn't know it. The point of this is that the woman came to the water not seeking Jesus, but Jesus went to the well seeking this woman. That's how God works. Romans 3 tells us that no one is righteous, no one seeks after God. It's not like God is the one who is lost and we found him, but we're the ones that are lost, and he found us. And so Jesus is there to reach this woman and to help her to experience true life. God continues to seek us. How does he seek us? He seeks us through circumstances. He allows us to go through trials and difficulties, oftentimes so that we would turn to him, but he is seeking us even through those difficult circumstances. He's seeking us when he allows us to make a mess of ourselves so that we can get to the end of ourselves so that we can turn to him. He's seeking us through people. Perhaps you had a grandma who faithfully prayed for you. Perhaps God brought someone into your life in your college years when you were wandering from the Lord to bring you back to him. Perhaps there's a coworker or a neighbor who has been a part of your life that God has been seeking you through people. God seeks us through music. Sometimes you'll turn on the radio and you'll hear a song and, wow, that was meant just for me. Or you'll hear a message and God is speaking to you, that God is seeking you. And that's what's happening here in the text, is that Jesus is seeking after this woman. And so the woman, after he says, give me some water, the woman said to him, how is it that you, a Jew, would ask a drink from me, a woman from Samaria? And then in parentheses, for Jews don't have any dealings with Samaritans. She understood the cultural context. And Jesus answered, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying it to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. And the woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. There's three shocking things going on here. Let me see a shocking face. Let me see your shocking face. Okay, so here's the three shocking things. I need to see three shocking faces. First is that a Jew is speaking to a Samaritan, that a man is speaking to a woman, and that the Jewish man is asking to use a water vessel of a Samaritan woman. This would be like you just going up to a stranger and saying, I see that you're drinking out of that water bottle. Can I have a swig too? Like, he doesn't have a vessel to draw water from, and he's saying to her, can you just draw me some? Can I drink from your vessel? And she is confused by all of this, and she says to him, well, where do you get this living water? Verse 12, are you greater than our father Jacob? He's the one who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. And Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this H2O will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of my water, the water that I will give to him, will never be thirsty again. The water that I give to him will become a spring of water welling up to eternal life. And the woman said to him, this is a pretty great deal. Sir, give me this water so I won't be thirsty and I don't have to come and draw out this water again. Jesus is offering her living water. She's thinking of like running water. She's thinking of, I don't have to come out to this well in the middle of the day. I can have like tap water at my house. Can you do that for me? But what Jesus is doing here is that he's creating a curiosity. He's helping her to see a need. He's revealing himself to her, and he's offering to change her life. But before he can change her life, she needs to address some things in her life, which brings us to point number two. Point number two is this: my awareness of sin is the start. Verse 16, so Jesus said to her, go call your husband to come here. And the woman said, I have no husband. And Jesus said to her, you're right in saying I have no husband, because you have five husbands in the past. And the one that you have now is not even your husband. So what you've said is true. Then she said, Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. The words of Jesus seem pretty insensitive, right? Here they are, strangers at a well, and he's getting to like some pretty personal, pretty private things. Is Jesus being insensitive? He's being loving. He's doing the most loving thing. Because here's the reality, is that without conviction of sin, there can be no conversion. Until we come to grips of our disobedience to God, that we can't be saved. So let's say you had a tumor and you went to the doctor. Is it insensitive for the doctor to say that you have a tumor? What if the doctor said, we need to remove that tumor and you have to have surgery? But that surgery is going to be painful. Isn't it insensitive that he would say that I have to go through something painful? But if that's what it takes to get healthy, you need to have a doctor that is loving enough to share the truth with you, but then offer a solution. And that's what Jesus is doing here in this passage with this woman. And so the very fact that he is beginning to talk to her about her past is beginning to expose to her pursuit of happiness. That she's been striving for happiness. She's had five husbands, and the one that she's living with now isn't even her husband. So no doubt it's not because she's been widowed five times. That's highly unlikely. But there's probably some promiscuity there. Maybe there's some men who have used her, but she is longing for happiness, and Jesus sees that in her. We long to be happy, don't we? If I were to ask you to raise your hand, how many of you want to be happy versus unhappy? I think all of us, our hands would go up, right? That absolutely, we live in the United States of America. We have life, liberty, and the pursuit of. And so we feel like we have this God-given right to be happy all the time. And I'm going to do the thing that's going to make me happy. And we're pursuing happiness. And if you've ever been on the pursuit of happiness, it either is temporary or it's empty or it leads to long-term regret. How do we pursue happiness? Let's think about this. We pursue happiness through people. If you're a teenager here or you're single, if only I had a boyfriend or a girlfriend, then I would be happy. So then you get your boyfriend or your girlfriend and you get married. Now I'm going to be happy. But then you hit some bumps in the road in marriage and I'm not happy, and divorce happens, not because of biblical grounds, but because I'm just not happy and I deserve to be happy. Then you have kids, and my kids are going to make me happy, and then they're a lot of joys, but there's some disappointments and it's hard, and I want friends, and my friends are going to make me happy, but they're not always there for me. And you see how we can fall into the trap of pursuing happiness through people? We pursue happiness through possessions. If only I had this, or if I had that, then I would be happy. And I'm not satisfied with an iPhone 7. I need to have an iPhone X. And then I'm going to be happy until the next model comes out. And then I'm not happy because I have the old model and I need to have a new model. And I just want to accumulate stuff. And then your house is full of junk. And you're like, I'm unhappy because my house is full of junk. It's outdated and I need to get rid of it. And then as soon as I get rid of all this stuff that used to make me happy, then I'm going to be happy. Do you see how it's just like a cycle? We pursue happiness through people and possessions. What about positions? I have a job, but I don't make enough money, and so I'm not happy. So I'm going to find another job that pays me more, but now I have a boss that doesn't make me happy. So I'm going to find another job. Well, it pays me and I like my boss, but it's way stressful and I'm not happy. And so it's just this cycle of, if only I got this promotion, then I'd be happy. And then the pursuit of happiness through pleasure, through entertainment, through alcohol, through sex, through fun, through addiction, drug addiction, pornography addiction, any addiction. What used to make me happy doesn't make me happy anymore, and I need it more frequently and I need it more intensely. Remember the phrase at the start? Only the power and presence of Jesus can satisfy and refresh the deepest longings of our soul. We're human beings, but we're also spiritual beings. That we have bodies, but we have souls, we have spirits. And God has created us in a way that we would long to have a relationship with our Creator. That God has created with inside of us this God-shaped vacuum that's not going to be filled apart from God Himself. And the only way that that can be filled is through a relationship with Jesus Christ Himself. And that is what Jesus is doing right here with the woman at the well. He is getting to her pursuit of happiness and the sin that has come and trying to be happy, and He's beginning to reveal Himself to her. That Jesus knows her, all of her flaws, but Jesus loves her. In the same way as Jesus relates to the woman at the well, Jesus knows all about you. And He is madly in love with you. We fear being fully known, because if we feel like people really know us, then we fear that we won't be fully loved. And so we try to hide ourselves from being known. But God knows all about you. You are fully known by God, and He fully loves you. There's nothing that you can do that would make God love you more. There's nothing that you can do that would make God love you any less. God loved you as you are, but as we're going to see with the Samaritan woman, that He loves you enough not to leave you as you are. That God loves you as you are, but He doesn't leave you as you are. And so Jesus is beginning to step on some toes, some things that are pretty sensitive to her. And if you're ever in a conversation with someone and it's going in a direction you don't want it to go, what do? You redirect the conversation, and that's what the woman does with Jesus. Gets us to point number three. My worship of God is the response. My worship of God is the response. So she begins to change the subject off of her to start to talk about worship. And she says in verse 20, our fathers worshipped up on this mountain, Mount Gerizim. But you say that in Jerusalem, that's the place where people ought to worship. And Jesus said to her, just so patiently, so loving to her, woman, believe me that the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. So she's caught up as to where to worship, and it's not about where to worship, but Jesus is redirecting it that it's not about where to worship, but it's who to worship. And He just very gently kind of says to her, you're entering into a topic that you really don't know anything about. Notice what Jesus says to her, for you worship what you don't know. Not all worship is the same. Not all religions are equal. Jesus says, we worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. God chose the Jewish people in the Old Testament. Jesus Himself is a Jew. It's not just limited to the Jews. but it's being extended to the Gentiles. It's being extended to her, but salvation first started from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and it's not just coming in the future, but it's now here in the present. When true worshipers, there must be false worshipers, so he's saying that there's true worshipers. True worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. That God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. If you want to take your pen, you can circle or you can underline the word worship or the root word worship in these few verses. You're going to find it 10 times in these verses. And Jesus is talking about that there is a true worship, and true worship is worshiping in spirit and in truth. That's what we're going for here on Sunday mornings when we gather for worship here at Harvest, is that we want to worship him in spirit and in truth. We want to worship him with our emotions, but we also want to worship him with our minds. We don't want to just sing about God, but we want to sing to God himself, that we don't want to just sing with our lips and go through the motions, but we want to sing with our minds and we want to sing from our hearts. We want to worship him in spirit and in truth. And the woman said to him, well, I know that there's a Messiah who is coming, verse 25. I think his name is called Christ. And when he comes sometime in the future, when he comes, he's going to tell us all these things. And Jesus says to her, I who speak to you am he. The Messiah is coming. I can't wait. I who speak to you am he. I'm the Messiah. I'm the Christ. In the Greek, it would be super clear, the original language that this would have been written in. This would be the way that he would have said it. The one who speaks to you, I am. The same I am of Exodus 3, who spoke to Moses in the burning bush. Jesus is revealing himself to her as the Messiah. Most theologians believe her genuine conversion happens in verse 27 because of what happens in verse 28, and we're going to see that. So point number four is this: my witness for God is the result. My witness for God is the result. Verse 27, just then the disciples came back. They're bringing back their fillet of fish, their chicken sandwiches to go. They marveled at what he was talking about with the woman, but no one dare say, what do you seek and why are you talking with her? So the disciples, they're kind of like, and John's one of his disciples, so he has the inside scoop to what's going on. And they see Jesus at the well with this woman. They're like, what's going on? And so then they come over to Jesus, and as they come over to Jesus, the woman left. She left her jar behind, and she went away into town, and she said to the people, come and see a man who told me everything that I did. Can this be the Christ? They went out from the town and were coming to him. So all she says is that he is told me everything that he knows about me. I think he's the Messiah. If you think about like a gospel presentation, it's not really complete, but it's really compelling. She's just sharing her story. She's sharing her testimony. This is what Christ has done in my life. You need to come and see for yourself. And so all the townspeople are starting to come to the well, but Jesus is there with his disciples. Meanwhile, verse 31, the disciples were urging him, Rabbi, eat. You know, they want to keep going, but he said to them, I have food to eat that you do not know about. And the disciples are like, has someone brought you something to eat? We were the one that was going to go get you food. Did someone else bring you carry out to go? And did you already eat without us knowing? And Jesus said to them, my food is this, to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. What a great sentence. I hope that that's the desire of your heart. The food of my life, the thing that I want to give my life for, is to do the will of my Father, to accomplish my Father's work. I want to be a part of my Father's business. And then verse 35, do not say There are yet 4 months, then comes the harvest. If you have a pen, I encourage you to underline these next words. Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see the fields are white for harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving his wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so the sower and the reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor. To know me would be to know how special John 4:35 is. It was 9 years ago, summer of 2010, that Camille and I gathered together with 40 people in the living room in Geneva. We knew about 20 of the people. The other 20 were meeting for the first time, and we were gathering together to talk about a vision of starting what is now our church, this campus here today. And God had laid upon my heart John 4:35. This is my journal from 2010. You mind if I read some things to you from my journal? Thinking about that evening, and I jotted down these things before I went. It's not often that you have an opportunity to be a part of something big from the very start, to be a part of something that alters eternity. Then I have John 4:35. Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes, see the fields, they are white to harvest. I wrote this. The context is Jesus and disciples traveling from Jerusalem to Galilee through Samaria. They came to a rest stop in Sychar. Disciples went into town to get fast food to go, and Jesus rested at the well and struck up a conversation with the woman at the well. And disciples returned with the extra value meal in hand, and Jesus said to them, look, I tell you, lift up your eyes. Sometimes we're doing good things, and we think that we're doing the thing that God wants us to do, but in the process, God may have something different for us, and he doesn't want to miss it. Are you willing to lift up your eyes? Let's consider the fields. Got some notes here about Aurora, and then Sugar Grove and Elburn and Batavia and North Aurora, Montgomery and Oswego and Yorkville. Do you see the fields? I wrote. And then I wrote this question. Do you believe they're white to harvest? What would happen when grain would grow is that it would turn white when it was ready to be reaped for harvest. So there would be a sower, Jesus is talking about this, and then there would be a reaper. There would be time to come and to reap. We have faith to believe that the fields in this area are white to harvest. And I wrote these words. By faith, I can say with confidence that people are going to come to know the Lord in 2011 because a Harvest Bible Chapel Aurora exists. Marriages are going to be strengthened and healed. Men and women are going to grow in the Lord. Teens are going to be discipled. Children are going to discover and experience the love of Christ. People are going to be baptized. And then I continue to write more. To think back to this being 9 years ago, to think back to that original group of people and the seed of faith that was planted, and to think about who we are today, this is God's grace. God has done exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ever ask or imagine. To him be the glory in the church forevermore. Amen? And so God has done great things in our church, in good seasons and in hard seasons. But the vision from John 4:35 is an eternal vision. It's in the Word of God. It's not a vision just for a day or for a season. It's not just limited to 2011. But the vision needs to remain strong in 2019. God has placed you in a home, in a workplace, in a school. Do you have faith to believe that the fields are white to harvest? One of the great fields that is white to harvest is that in kids' ministry. I love the Awana ministry. Check this out.
We do our best to raise our children. From their first steps to their first recital, first game, first love, first breakup. First date to the day they move out. And then they're gone. And we ask ourselves, did we do our best to raise them? Did we leave a life-defining, long-lasting, spiritual impact? 92.7% of Awana alumni attend church weekly or more often and say it was important in developing a spiritual and moral foundation for their adult life. In fact, 92.9% place such a high value on the impact of Awana that they said that they would like their own children to participate in Awana ministry someday. And it's not just church attendance that's sticking. They read their Bible and pray regularly, engage in missions, and spend more time volunteering in their community. We are Awana, and we are equipping families to know, love, and serve Jesus Christ with an unshakable faith that endures for a lifetime.
Psalm 90 tells us, teach us to number our days that we might gain a heart of wisdom. This video hits me at a lot of different places. Our kids are only in our house for so long. Our oldest son is in 9 days going off to college. What is it that we've invested in him and in our other teenage children? I'm a product of Awana. I grew up going to Awana clubs. I remember the games. I remember my leaders. I remember the fun. I remember the verses that I memorized. I'm thankful that my parents had a commitment to have me be a part of Awana. Awana is going to start in after Labor Day. It's Wednesday night Bible program, club program that happens during the school year. I share that video with you because the fields are white to harvest, and it's not just for you as parents. If you have kids that are preschool through fifth grade, to be a part of it, I hope that you'll take that opportunity to involve your kids in Awana. But what about laboring in the harvest fields of Awana? Maybe you're here and that would be a ministry that you could be a part of, that you could be a part of sowing and reaping in a child's life. Maybe it's not just dropping off my kids and doing something while childcare is happening for them. Or maybe you're an empty nester and your kids are now out of the house, and you can give back to some kids, not just in our church, but in our community. Katie and Bridget tell me that a third of the kids don't even come to harvest that are a part of Awana. What a field that is white to harvest. After the last service, they were flooded with people wanting to learn more about Awana, and even better yet, wanting to learn how to serve in Awana. Maybe after this service, that would be a logical next step for you, is to go find out how you can be a part of that ministry. If we're going to impact this community, we need to get outside the walls of our building. We have an opportunity to join with other churches here in the Aurora area for 40 days of life, starting the end of September, going through November. Did you know that the leading cause of death in the world is abortion? 42 million children are aborted every year. One of the largest Planned Parenthood clinics is right here in Aurora. 400 children are lost every month in our community. 40 Days of Life is about helping that cause. It's not picket fences, not being angry. If you were at church last weekend, we don't do this to shame people. But it's a chance for the Church of Jesus Christ to rise up and to pray for 40 days for life here in our community, getting outside the walls of our church, because the fields are white to harvest. So the woman, she goes into Sychar, into town, and she's telling all these people, you got to come, you got to see Jesus. And many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I had ever did. And so when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And Jesus stayed there in Sychar for 2 more days. And many more believed because of his words. So many believed, and many more believed. And they said to the woman, verse 42, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe. For we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this indeed is the Savior of the world. Think about this woman and the little mustard seed of faith that she had. And God used her little faith to impact her neighbors and her neighborhood and her whole community for Christ, so that they could say for themselves, this indeed is the Savior of the world. Do you believe that Jesus is the Savior of the world? If you've not yet confessed that with your mouth and in your heart, today is the day of salvation. And if you believe he is the Savior of the world, why is it that we're not more like the Samaritan woman? May this everyday woman with an uncommon faith be an inspiration for us. I love it that our worship team writes new songs. One of my favorite songs is All We Have and All We Need is Found in You. If all you want and all you need is found in Jesus, let's stand and sing as a response.